All right, what's up, guys?
I'm gonna jump right into it.
This right here is a
stencil that I downloaded.
The website is called
Brands of the World. I'll link it into this in the description and let them know with this video. But basically, it's a website where you can go in and you can search out different logos, and it has it in vector form. So if you have a vinyl plotter or anything like that, you're able to download off of this website and use them for purposes like this. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to add this logo on the side of this flame tank. I did a live on this, the same flames that are on this tank. You'll just have to go back and look. I think it was last week. So if you want to check that out, go ahead. You just go into my page there and it should be there.
So I
printed this out on my vinyl plotter and weeded it out. And basically, next thing we're going to do is transfer it onto the part about right here where you'd normally see
a Bar and Shield logo.
That's what I'm going to do.
I just use this. Any kind of masking tape is
going to work.
Okay, we got that stuck on. I'm gonna use that to transfer it onto the tank. All right, that worked nice. Okay, and the
kind of really have to get a good eye at this. I know exactly where I'm going to put this because I did the other side of the tank. But I like to have the tank laying out flat and then I'll place it on sideways. For this video, I'm just going to do it just like this because I know exactly where it's going to go.
I like to start at one side.
If you lay it all down at once on this curve, it'll end up rolling up on you.
Kind of hold pressure on this
end of the tape.
If you get a couple of air bubbles,
the way that we're painting this, it really doesn't matter. But,
you can kind of just work it into the design. But really, you want to get it as good as you can. All right, get that pressed down. All right, it looks like there's a
couple of wrinkles. We're just gonna
slice that and roll it over. Yeah, that came out pretty good. All right, next step.
I'm going to load up my airbrush. Here it is right here. It's actually already loaded up.
This is an Iwata HP CS. This basically does all of my work. It'll do fine detail.
It'll do stuff fire like we're doing here. It'll do everything. This thing's a good airbrush.
You can find this on the...
In the description, there'll be a link to the Amazon affiliate link that... that'll have the paint that I'm going to use, this airbrush, and a lot of, pretty much everything that I use is on that affiliate link. So check it out. By using
that, it kind of helps
support this channel. I can do more lives and stuff like that. So yeah, look at it. You can buy it right on Amazon. Appreciate it. So
I loaded this up with
Speedo Coat brand white base coat.
Let's stick it out here to make sure it's spraying okay. All right. So it's just white base coat reduced.
We're basically just going to wash it over just a little bit with just kind of a smoke.
Kind of a smoky look. I'm not going all crazy. That's better. See, I'm just blending it out.
Not going all crazy right now.
Lightly putting in some white. And then I'm just doing kind of a
smoky fire.
Just kind of go,
you know, kind of like what fire and smoke would usually do, is just kind of go up and down and kind of roll around.
We're just kind of doing the base
layer of everything, so it's not like we're trying to do any kind of detail.
I'm just gonna roll that out like that. We're gonna add this same kind of
smoke around in the black.
Design here. Try to kind of stay away
from the edges because I'm gonna be applying a blue candy.
And I really don't want too much of
the blue to go onto the flame.
So I kind of just kind of aim more towards the center. Just some coming out of this fuel spout
here, rolling around.
Yeah, airbrushing fire is not like one
of those things where you airbrush a spot and you're done. It's not like that. You kind of get build it up in layers. You kind of do it all at once to get kind of mapped in.
And then we're going to go over and
give it some more detail.
And then sometimes you kind of break
away at the end where you don't have to actually connect it all. It's kind of like a
kind of a flame that's kind of broken off. You see how I'm just kind of like, it doesn't really, especially
this base layer, it's just kind of, it doesn't really matter what you do. You don't want to like do zigzags, and kind of just still roll with your airbrush.
Like, see that right there?
Just kind of like, just
make a little squiggly
for now, and then we'll build off of that here in a second.
Okay, looks like we got kind of the first
layer down there. We know everything's kind of rolling around.
We'll go do this right here too. All right, now that we have that done, we're gonna grab a stencil. Let's see, I think this is a Craig Fraser
stencil, if I'm not mistaken. You can get these on the affiliate link. You can also make them just out of a piece of paper.
You just draw these shapes out,
these random shapes. They don't need to be exactly like this, but you know, the best ones are like this one right here.
Just kind of draw them out and you cut it
out with a razor blade and you have the same thing.
But yeah, check it out.
Those are on there.
So basically what we're going to do is just to create some hard edges. Generally
what I try to do is stay inside of what I've already done. Like, you're not going to put a hard edge like way out here. We're going to kind of try to stay in
the confinement of what we've
already kind of sprayed out. So.
But yeah, I like to start.
If you have an object that you're spraying around like this, I like to start with that and kind of move off.
But using just different sides
of the stencil here and there.
See how that just kind of flows
right off of that edge.
And then just roll that
around.
And it's just really a whole lot of that.
You know, it's find a hard, you get the hard line there and you just kind of work off of that.
When the fire is big,
I like to start big and then go smaller. And then once you get towards the end, you can even, like I was saying before, you can even kind of cut it off to where this is like out here. But I like to almost kind of create like a connection between everything all the way through. That way it's not like broken off all over. I see that on a lot of people's fireworks, just like patches or a whole lot of stencil that really doesn't flow. Another thing is making sure you keep
your airbrush
paint super thin. If this was
thick, it wouldn't look the same.
So definitely going on the thinner side to where it's not going to blow out or run or anything like that. But it's one thing to definitely pay attention to.
I also like to take the
stencil. Some of the main shapes that I do is.
Yeah, I'll put one right here. I like to flip it around
and then just do another shape like right here.
Let's see. So see how that kind of created that little piece of flame.
And then you can come off and,
you know, freehand that. And then just kind of build off of everything. See how this shape is right there?
You probably wouldn't want to put another one right next to it. You know, you'd switch it up to where it like went this way.
That way it kind of builds some
area in there.
Always try to go with like the
flow of the fire. So I kind of imagine this kind of like the smoke and the fire kind of like turbulating through there and like kind of flowing through.
So when I spray down these patterns,
I try to do that to complement that. So instead of doing like, you know, maybe like that, I mean, it's not going to be wrong because it could always just look like it's coming straight out of the back of that. That's just kind of the way I do it. It seems like it has a nice whiskey flow to it.
And to be honest with you, see these inside of these things, I
never use the insides.
I never.
When I say I never, I really never do. I always use these outside edges right here. Like I'm not gonna spray that in there.
Because then it just doesn't look right. These outside ones are really the ones you're gonna be using. See how they kind of just connect those together? And instead of using like, so I got that shape right there.
Try not to reuse that same shape.
Even if it's in a different direction, I try not to use that reshape, that same shape. So, I mean, something like this to where it creates a little bit of a difference. All right, I think that's gonna do it for that. layer so far. What we're going to do next is we're going to
go in and detail the bar shield up a little bit.
So I got the same white that I had doing the flames there. And I'm just doing some dagger strokes.
Back and forth, going in one direction. I guess I have no direction. Just adding to the opaqueness of the white. We're really trying to drive this white in there. And it takes multiple coats to get it there. And that's really what we want. You know, we could just make it really thick and spray it all on at once, but it's going to have a different look. By going slow and you're creating a texture in layers,
it's definitely to your benefit. Stuff's gonna look better.
Just by going slower and adding layers, it's just a better way
to get more of a realness
and more of a texture, a better look to everything.
Nope, just ran out of paint. We're going to make sure we have the edge pretty bright, because we don't
want it to go away once we put a little fire over it.
See, it's starting to whiten up right there. It looks great. All right. Okay, when I go to pull these stencils off,
I do use these Limeline plastic razor blades. They're awesome. If you try to use a regular razor blade every time,
even if you're good, I swear, every time you just poke into your paint and it puts a mark in it. And even some of the best paint
jobs I've looked at, if you look real close where you can see they've done stencil work like this, you can see where they've maybe jabbed it and put just like a little
spot in the paint. Once you've done them and you've seen them,
it's like they stand out like crazy.
So these help prevent that. Couple more here. All right, yeah, you can see.
No gouge marks. So these things are awesome. You can get these on my Amazon affiliate link that's down in the description. After this video, that'll be there. So, and also if you're didn't catch the first part, this stencil will also be in the description of where you can download the stencil. And if you have a vinyl cutter, you can print it out. So you can do the same exact thing.
All right, next I'm going to take the same color of white.
And I'm just going to lightly
paint over the barn shield we have here. Just going to give it a little bit of detail. Next, I'm going to take just
a hard piece of paper.
In that same diagonal
direction, I'm just going to put some hard lines in there.
It kind of gives it like a metal shiny
look. Ah, you see that? Kind of gives it a texture.
It's different than what
we have going on here. So I can easily just use the
texture stencil and
make the same stuff we got going on here, but I like to change it up. You kind of have a couple of different looks.
So I feel like having given this one
a little bit of like a metal grain to it is what I guess you can call it.
Mix that in with some freehand. All right. Next, I'm going to add some blue candy. We have it right here. It's actually blue and purple candy.
House of color. Mixed in with some intercoat clear.
And I reduced it with urethane reducer. And all that stuff's on that
Amazon link in the description.
Go ahead and fill that up. Let's see here. Yeah, somebody just
commented, can you do a video on how to do realistic flames? These are kind of like the same thing as realistic flames that I'm doing right now. It's not in a realistic color. It's just in a blue color. But yes, I will do one of those once I have a job that's like that.
This is actually a customer's
job.
So if I have that job, I
usually do a live ad.
All right, I loaded that up
in the airbrush and thinned it out a little bit.
So this is House of Color
candy cobalt blue.
And the cool thing about candies
is they're transparent. So what I'm doing right now is, you know, I'm not really covering up what I'm doing. I'm just tinting it blue.
The more paint you put down,
the richer and the darker the blue will get. And you see right there where I'm really starting to pile it in.
For this project,
I don't want to totally blue in all of the barn shield here, and it kind of buries it. So I like to keep
at least the center of it
light blue or almost the color it is.
And this, I'm not really, I'm just
kind of just covering it to cover it. I'm not really doing anything to make any kind of detail.
I do kind of put more.
You see like the little holes like right here. I do kind of drive a little more paint into those areas. Like
right here to kind of make it look like
it's like
way down in the background.
Down.
All right, that's looking pretty good. I'm gonna go in here. You really have to be careful
with overspray if you're not wanting to put blue paint on the flames themselves.
Just kind of got to get closer and just make sure you're
spraying in the right direction.
If you don't want to get it on there,
just come from this direction. Like if you were to spray in this direction, you're gonna get overspray up all up into there.
That's why it's really important to just kind of know which angles you're spraying at. You could always just tape the flames off.
That's a lot more work to do that, but
and a little bit's okay.
I mean, you do want a little bit of a glow. That's why I do it freehand. You do want a little bit of a glow. Of blue onto the flames.
I think it looks good anyways. You can see that the more that you spray on there, the darker it gets. A little bit more on the bottom here. All right, there it is. Next step is, so that's basically just the background of the fire. This is kind of the
first layer.
So we're going to go ahead and move on.
We should go back to the light, or the light back into the airbrush.
All right. Now we got the white loaded back up. Basically, we're going to do the same thing we did before. We're going to use
the stencil.
And we're going to build up what we already have.
We don't necessarily want to go on the same. We definitely don't want to go on the same marks that we had before. We're just trying to stay more towards the inside, and we're just going to build like another layer on top of what we already have.
We're also kind of going to mix
this logo in
into the smoky flames right here. So you kind of see how that just kind of blew. Somebody just asked if I've
done any old school scallops, and yeah, I have. I actually have a video out on scallops. If you look
into my page there,
I'll say how to paint. I think it's aged paint.
Paint aged paint, and that's in a scallop design.
So I'll show you how to take that out.
You see how I'm just kind of spraying
over the logo here?
Just trying to mix that
last part in
the fire a little bit. Kind of building a layer of
smoke over the top. I don't want to lose all this detail I have here. I'll make sure I kind of stay
one side. You see how light I'm spraying to you.
I'm putting some lines in here, some hard lines, but you know, it's just barely getting it in a couple of spots to kind of give it some more depth.
Because really, fire is just
when it's hot, it's just real wild. It kind of just wants to go everywhere, so.
Know what we're doing. Kind of see that one just kind of broken off
there.
But if you can see, everything kind of has just
a scream to it.
Roll some of this out of this gas cap. See, I already have a mark right here.
I try not to like get that straight up, you know, kind of right there.
That way,
you're not just duplicating everything you have. everything you've just done.
So you kind of just, you go off a little bit,
kind of steer off to the other side.
All right. All right, so the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to load it back up with glue. And this time I'm not going over the whole design.
Kind of hitting the dark areas.
You'll notice once you clear
coat this that a lot of the, what you see as white will kind of shift to a blue.
Naturally, the candies
and the white will kind of blend together once clear coat hits them.
So that's why you kind of
want to leave it, your hot spots a little brighter, knowing that they're going to kind of go a little darker once you clear them. There you have it. I'll actually, once this gets cleared, I'll do a little bit more detail on top of another round of clear.
I guess
a lot of people don't know. I mean, if you're new, sometimes you don't know that. When I first learned this is, if you paint something and you clear coat it, that doesn't mean you're done. That doesn't mean you have to be done. You can
sand the clear coat with
600 grit, and you can do another layer over the top. So if you have some errors that you need to fix, like some overspray, and you feel like, well, you know, I'm just going to go ahead and clear coat this, let it dry, sand it, and then basically you can go through and fix your errors or add more detail to certain areas. Like this, once I clear it, a lot of this what that looks lighter white is going to turn blue. And that's great, and that's going to look good, but I want a little more detail and a little more pop to it. So clear coating it kind of buries everything. The way that I kind of can best describe it is, if you know anything about Photoshop, that you can create layers
from Photoshop. So
if you have an image and you want to, say, draw on that image, you can just create a new layer. And that's basically the same thing that we do here.
Is if we're done with this particular portion of it, then
we'll just clear coat it and then sand it and we come back when we can do more detail on top of that, and then re-clear coat it again.
I do that a lot.
A lot of the stuff gets clear, goes through clear three times. You can see this
is a double graphic. It has
these flame graphics that I did in a previous live,
and I clear coated it since
then. So these edges are not edges; they're all the way cleared over. If I made a mistake or I dropped some paint on there, I could wipe it off or sand it off. That's the other nice thing. So just remember that. You can always do more layers. If it's not, if you're doing a paint job and it's not coming out that great, or you're starting to clear it and things are going bad, just put enough clear coat on there that you can sand it out.
You can sand it smooth, and then you can just, you know, touch it up from there and
fix your errors and fix mistakes and re-clear it. And you can do that, you know, multiple times, and that's what I do, and that's what I've learned over the course of my career, that you can always just finer tune it after it's clear coated and sanded.
So that's
it, guys. I really appreciate you guys checking in and watching this. And if you have any questions,
you know, hit me up in the comments.
I check those all the time. And yeah, appreciate you guys watching. Thanks.